Welcome back to my Mental Health and Crime Channel. My name is Huda London. This is for education purpose only. I'd like to start by thanking all my subscribers, my viewers, for all your kind, thoughtful comments, your mindfulness, respect. I really appreciate each and every subscriber and viewer. I made a couple of clips on my other channel. I hope people would subscribe to Psychology and Crime. The link is in the community channel. I'm basically trying to move to the second channel because of issues with this channel. But I haven't given up on this case. I have no intentions of giving up on the Idaho 4. On my other channel, I just uploaded a clip that I was talking about XANA and E and their timeline. Nobody saw them between 9 to 1:45. There was an investigation going out for them, especially with the Sigma Chi fraternity, because there was a party that night at the Sigma Chi fraternity. Obviously, nobody's willing to speak up. It's a party. You can imagine how many people are in a party. But for whatever reason, everyone is scared to speak up. And I don't blame them. This case was handled in a very unprofessional way at the start. I don't blame Idaho Moscow because it's a small town. And the police officers are not used to such a brutal incident. I believe the last incident they have of someone who was unalived was 7 years before this incident took place on the 13th of November. So I personally would have assumed that the police would have out of professionalism have contacted the FBI immediately. Because let's not forget, the surviving roommates, for whatever reason, took 8 to 9 hours to call Hunter Johnson, who ended up calling the police. We ended up calling 911. We don't know what was moved in the house. We don't know what was touched in the house. We don't even know how the victims were found, in which rooms they were found. The timeline in the beginning was between 3 to 4 a.m. The surviving roommates were clearly not witnesses, according to Chief Fry. If you listen to both the press conferences, they said to ABC reporter that no, Chief I was very firm in his voice. He said, I did not say the surviving roommates were witnesses. I said they were just there. And that didn't make sense. So at the start, I don't think even the chief or the FBI, I personally don't think they even trusted the surviving roommates. Nothing made sense to them. So they must have said, just wait. Y'all will hear from us, and don't talk to any reporters, don't talk to any social media, don't talk to anyone, otherwise y'all will get arrested. It's possible. So I wonder what the surviving roommates must have told the police. They must have told them, we heard some noises and all, because they can't lie. Their phone will prove who they were talking to and who they were texting. If it's true, what was leaked from the grand jury, that the surviving roommates were texting each other during this horrific incident, then they can't lie about that because there's the data trace. They'll have to explain themselves. Okay, y'all were scared. If they say we were scared, we couldn't call the police. Y'all were scared that the person left. Let's not forget, DM said she saw the person leaving. So if you saw the person leaving, but you not calling the cops to make me believe that You were okay with the situation. You weren't scared of the person. Although that's the first thing common sense would have made us do. I know it's not right for anyone, not for me or for anyone, to be judging what the surviving roommates were thinking. Maybe they were told not to talk. So I don't know what they were thinking or what they were told. Well, I'm talking about the aftermath. After these four beautiful souls were deleted, and they took 8 hours to call the cops, after that, what happened wasn't right, because we don't know how many people were inside and outside that house. We don't know if anyone touched Maddie, his bed covers, because the knife sheet was allegedly found there. We don't know if anyone put anything there or took out anything from the crime scenes. And it was written in the Airmail article that was written by Howard Blum. So how can Howard Blum be so fine to say now in his new book that he believes that BK did it? He himself knows that there were many people in the house that weren't supposed to be there. So that is not getting correct justice. He writes a storytelling, whether it's fiction or whether it is facts. Doesn't matter, but it's a storytelling. And nobody's in a mood for storytelling, especially not me. I want to know what happened to these four beautiful victims. He said that taking interviews of certain people. To start with, BK's family would never turn against their son. They said from the beginning of this case, we stand with our son, and our son is not guilty. So for Howard Blum to be coming and saying that BK's sister, who's a counselor or a therapist, said that no, she went to tell her dad that there's something wrong with BK and that she believes he could be involved. Why would BK's sister, BK's father, throw their son under the bus? That doesn't make sense. Even BK's first lawyer in Pennsylvania, Jason LeBron, I wanted to show you all, he said an article in the newspaper. He said that it was really unprofessional of Howard Blum, Mr. Blum, to be writing a book about his storytelling at a time like this when the court hasn't started. And that was the first thing I've always said from the beginning. How can people be writing books of a case that hasn't gone to court yet? They're still disputing about which court they're going to have the case in, the trial in. And we can already see so much injustice being done, because Brian Kroberg is entitled to a fair trial. What if it was not him who did it? Or what if it is him who did it and he gets away because they don't have enough evidence and he walks and more students or more victims can be created, can come out of this? So then I really don't understand. I'm sure the FBI and the police have some evidence for them to be going to the direction of BK, but explain yourselves. Where's the 3 unidentified male DNAs? How come nobody talks about it anymore? That makes me believe it was 3 different organizations or 3 different groups of people, maybe one of each group, who came to do this horrific crimes. It could be possible. Where did the 3 unidentified male DNAs come from? Pay attention, they said it's male DNAs. They never said it's female DNAs. And it's not the surviving roommates, obviously, neither the victims, because their DNA will be the first to be checked. I'm sure Hunter's DNA and his girlfriend Emily must be lying there every day. So you can imagine thousands and thousands of small DNAs were in that house, from hair to all kind of DNA traces. But who put that knife sheet there? Did that belong to BK? Or did that belong to someone else? Because this was a crime scene that no one had in control. It depends when these unalivings happened. If they happened between 3 to 4, 2 to 3, or 4 to 4:30. Whatever time it happened, the police won't call till 8 hours later. And if it happened at 3 a.m. or before that, that would make it 9 hours. So what was going on in this house? Was they cleaning? Was there partying? Were people taking pictures of themselves? Were people trying to allegedly stage a crime scene? Were they cleaning? A guy was wearing a green jacket and a black mask. Y'all must have seen that black ski mask everywhere. Was seen outside the house at 3:31 at night, a.m., in front of 1122 King's Road. So how many people were there with masks? Was this something that could have been done by the frats and the sororities? Did these girls and victims piss off people? Just asking questions. Because something is not right here. I don't believe a stalker just gets bored and doesn't even worry about going to a house that has a dog and 5 people there, and he doesn't even know if more people will be coming, maybe for an after party or anything. This was a known party house. So who would take the chance? It has to be someone who knows the place. It has to be someone who's angry, someone who's bitter, somebody who's full of rage. And I really wonder who did this. Who could have been so full of rage to have done this crime and have no empathy? Whoever did this has to be an antisocial personality disorder person. They have to have symptoms of sociopath and psychopath in them, I believe. Honestly, because we're talking about 4 human beings. And sometimes something tells me, follow the money. There has to be something to do with money. Because the whole grub truck looked like everyone was paying attention, observing. There was a proper surveillance tag going on Kaylee and Maddie, in my opinion. I only know why XANA asked her father to fix her locks. Fixed locks can be, maybe he fixed it and tightened it. Maybe the screws were getting loose. Or maybe he changed the whole lock plate. I want to know, why did XANA want her lock to be fixed or changed? Was she under some kind of threat? Did she feel like her stuff was stolen? Did she feel like somebody was stalking her? Or could it be because somebody was stalking Kaylee, according to Maddie, telling the man in the vape shop, who owns the vape shop, that they're looking after Maddie because they're looking after Kaylee because somebody is actually stalking Kaylee? Is that the reason XANA could have asked her father to tighten her locks or change her locks? Did something happen 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks before 13th of November? What happened? What could have happened? We saw the Halloween party where they were in costumes. DM did not look at all happy to be in those pictures. She looks like she's getting bullied somehow. Could have just been an innocent costume party, but it didn't look like the way Maddie was sitting on Dylan and she's trying to open her mouth and pull something from the can to Dylan's mouth. And XANA had a leg on top of Dylan so that she couldn't move. What was actually going on? Could this have something? And that was 2 weeks before this incident. Let's not forget, DM was a new roommate. And I believe Kaylee was a new roommate too. So what they're doing, what's it called? Chores and favors and all, so they could be accepted by the roommates on 1122 Kings Road. Were they being tested? And let's not forget, Maddie is a senior. So is Kaylee. Kaylee didn't live much in the house, but Maddie was a senior. And the pictures of Maddie and DM did not look right at all. We saw DM looking very sad and confused and sitting by herself with a clown outfit on Halloween. I wonder if that had, if sometimes pictures can explain a lot of things, I believe. So I wonder if that was some kind of explanation that there was things going on in the house that not everyone was happy of. I wonder if it was some kind of beef going on within the roommates inside the house, or with the Sigma Chi and the 4chan beef they were talking about. I think somebody just took the fight too seriously. There was something that was happening before that, but somebody decided that they were not going to take this anymore. Maybe one of the Davids. David L, if he's on roids, steroids, you can imagine what would go on in his head. And all those symptoms of anger and, you can imagine, rage. Must have felt humiliated. Must have felt ashamed. He wanted to get back and attack them. Or maybe it became too overwhelming. It became too much. Maybe things didn't go according to the plan. I believe this was something more than one person who did it. Definitely, it wasn't one person. One person couldn't have, unless they're John Wick, they couldn't have done this incident within, what, 17, 18 minutes? Max 20 minutes, I doubt. I believe people were already hiding and waiting inside the house before Kaylee and Maddie came. And I've said in my other clip on my other channel, if you watch it, I've said that I believe that these are two separate incidents. I've always said that. People who know my channel and know me know I've said that from the beginning, and I still remain to that fact that this is two separate incidents. Yes, they all, I possibly, were targets, unfortunately, and yes, they all were not only targets, they were targets in two different incidents. I believe Maddie and Kaylee had the same suspects, and I believe the couple, XANA and E, had their own ones. Sigma Chi, I believe, personally, in my opinion, were involved with the couple, XANA and E. And I believe something happened to them between 2 to 2:15 when the crowd is yelling, "XANA, XANA," at the grub truck. And we heard XANA, we heard E's mother saying 2 a.m. is the hardest time for their family. So pay attention to the time between 2 to 2:15. A lot is going on with XANA and E. And then we have the mother that I will keep on mentioning, who said her son is E's friend, and E texted him at 2:10 or 2:15 saying that he was at the Sigma Chi, he was on his way home. So did something happen to E and XANA while they were at the Sigma Chi, or did they get in some trouble on the way home? We heard a female yelling, "Stop it, stop." What about the Mary and Kaylee? I believe their unalivings happened later on, before 3 a.m., or at least between 5 past. Now, somewhere between 2:52 to 3:16, I believe, something happened to Kaylee and Mary. If you pay attention to all the things that are happening, the figures running at 3:12, you see the truck passing Taylor Avenue, coming from 1122 Kings Road aside. You see the lights flashing. All that is happening at 3:01. And then 2:54 is when you hear the female yelling. No, sorry, 2:56 is when you hear female yelling, "Stop it, stop." You see Maddie's jacket lying in the bushes. I think something could have happened with the girls when they came home, because let's not forget, the News Nation reporter plus Brian Enton, both of them said when they're standing in front of the house, especially the other reporter who was explaining to Banfield, Banfield from Ashley Banfield, basically, from News Nation. He was saying that when he dropped the girls off, Maddie and Kaylee, the private Uber share driver or private driver, he said that the only music you could hear and the people were only partying that night, he said he could hear, was from the Sigma Chi. So there was a loud party going on at the Sigma Chi. We can't deny that. And that means the couple were already at the Sigma Chi. And if that boy, whose mother saying she told the FBI, texted E at 2:10 to 2:15, I wonder why the police and the FBI did not decide to change the timeline and to tell people that they texted and they were last seen there. But their telephone tracks are going to tell everything about not only the four victims. I don't understand why they didn't track the other phones. I wonder if the police checked everyone's phones. Like, example, when they're investigating the Sigma Chi, did they check everyone's phone thoroughly? Or is it just 3-4 people like the Davids and the Jacks? I hope they did a thorough investigation, because something was not right. I hope they went and checked through number 8, number 9, Jovito, the can Coca-Cola, what he was doing. Saeed, the pictures he was watching. I wish even Ann Taylor watches them and sees what he's watching, because how could he know that Kaylee was found in the sitting position? When I mentioned what Saeed was watching in his pictures was not now. I mentioned that long, long, long time ago, over a year ago. I don't understand why they're not even investigating that. He's clearly watching some crime scene pictures. So is Jovito. So is many other people at the grub truck. And it's all filled up in my channel. So I don't understand. What happened to the couple? Did someone delete them on the way? Was there a fight camp going on? Fight club? What was going on? Whatever fight has happened, did it continue to Taylor Avenue or to Linda Lane? What exactly was going on that night? They keep on saying it was a quiet night. There was nothing quiet about that night, I doubt. Nothing at all. The cops are busy talking to the young boys, telling them everything, what cars they drive and what's the reason their budget is low. And they didn't go and check what the guys threw in the field. They could have thrown weapons and come back and collected it later. They could have thrown ski masks. You had Saeed with bushy eyebrows roaming there. The other tall guy from the other three in Banfield had bushy eyebrows too. Just giving you all examples, I'm not discriminating anyone. Think about that. There were many people with bushy eyebrows. So it's not fair just because Dylan said bushy eyebrows that Brian Christopher Koberger his bushy eyebrows is exactly the bushy eyebrows DM saw. I doubt that because she said the man she saw was 5'10", 5'11". BK is clearly 6'1", 6'2". So she couldn't have mistaken herself on that too. Then the car was a mistake. They said 2011 to 2016. No, 2011 to 2013 Hyundai Elantra. White one was what they're searching for. But later on, they thought maybe we'll settle for less. Let's go for 2016. I'm not saying that's what happened, but things don't make sense. I've spent months and weeks and days, over a year on this case. I've been researching behind the scenes. I've been watching all the videos again and again, all the mainstream videos from the first minute it happened, trying to figure out where things could have gone wrong. And the only thing I can still come with is that this is two separate incidents. Two separate incidents. I want to know where Emily and Hunter were that night. I'd love to know where Jake was, Maddie's boyfriend. Jack D said he was sleeping. A BS alibi. I doubt. He had the most injuries that at least I can see of. In his hands and everywhere. And I'm still wondering if Kaylee had a sock. I spoke about that too in my other channel. Please follow the community guide link and I leave the link below for my new channel, Psychology and Crime. Because I'm trying to make more videos there and I'm trying to fix up that channel so that I can do much more in this case and maybe future cases. There's so much going on YouTube, you all must have noticed. The whole of last night I had a headache. I was just watching some creators and the Sebastian case, the missing poor boy. Thank God I haven't interfered in that case because I just wanted to sit and take a back seat and watch what happens because it's sad we YouTube creators and YouTubers say we're here to help for cases, but some YouTube creators and some people just run away with the cases. And by being selfish and not thinking that the missing people have loved ones too, this is not our job. We are just true crime fanatics and we just love to watch and try to help to get justice. But that doesn't make us investigators or the police of the case. We can give our opinions in our opinion, say allegedly and such things, but we have no right to be taking these cases in a place where it's hard for these families to get justice for the missing loved ones. But what is sad is I've been watching a couple of creators and they've been arguing and fighting over racist terms, actually. They're using all kind of discrimination is involved in this case, allegedly, with creators talking about black people and calling them really nasty, nasty names. And I'm sure most of you know what I'm talking about, but that doesn't really bother me because I'm here to get justice for these four innocent victims, to find out who did this, the Idaho incident, and even to find some of us. I've been working so much long on that case, but that case too was destroyed by YouTubers, just like the Quentin Simon case, many other cases. And it's just few people who go out of the way to discriminate other people. That shows something about low IQ, low self-esteem. Once people have that hate and that attitude towards other people because of their skin color or because of their looks or their nationality or the culture, religion, or the sex gender, it becomes a very sad thing. And that shows in counseling, in therapy, we try to tell people to work on themselves. So when they're talking so much nastiness about black people, I'm a colored woman, it hurts my feelings to listen to it. But then I think to myself, I don't have time to educate these ignorant people, because honestly, that is part of ignorance. When you don't have education, when you don't have a clean heart, you start getting into things that is out of order, like being a racist and discriminating other genders and other people. Another things that offend people, that hurt people, that make people get into mental health illnesses. And that is really sad and disturbing. So we always try to negotiate, we always try to hold ourselves, especially in this channel, with positive people. We don't have time for negativity. Anyone who is out for drama and negativity is just sad for them, because that just goes out on you as a human being. It's always important to think positive. Be a helping hand for the world. Help people, assist people. Love people instead of creating so much hate and problems that are unnecessary. Especially true crime, we're here to help people, missing people, people who need justice. And it is already a crime to pass racist remarks, because it is of criminally offensive for us or for other people to hear these rude comments and remarks. Nobody deserves that. And we as parents are supposed to teach our children love, not hate. We're supposed to teach our children to love people for how they behave towards them, for who they are, not for their skin color, not for their looks, not if they're rich or poor, if they're ugly or beautiful, if they're black or white, if they're mixed race or Belation or Malaysian or whatever race, it doesn't really matter. What matters is that we look after ourselves, look after our loved ones, look after all the damages that are happening in the world. Deal with our inside problems, with our own issues, instead of taking it out to the world, and instead of just being another hater or another racist or another negative person that doesn't bring anything good to this world. And it's sad. They have messed up this case of this young boy who is missing Sebastian. Really sad. Just because people want views, they're just being selfish. They don't care who they walk over. And that is really sad. I hope we find Sebastian. I hope they find him. I hope the correct justice is served. I hope that young man is found alive, because none of these people are even mentioning his names. They're too busy using that little 15-year-old boy's name so that they can create really negative things. Please like, share, and subscribe. Have a lovely evening.